Supervisor Dave Roberts, and this is the 75th anniversary of this historic building that we're in, and we're just so pleased to be able to host this forum here today. I first have to start and thank the county staff and our deputy sheriffs. They have been phenomenal in helping pull this event off today. So, gentlemen and ladies, thank you all so much for your hard work in such a short period of time. For the past 8 years, I had served on the Solana Beach City Council up north of here and had gotten interested in the issue around San Onofre. And 3 weeks before the nuclear power plant stopped operating, I had a chance to go tour it. And I try to tell people I'm not the reason they shut it down, but it was an interesting tour to go out and see the plant. And I had gone to see the plant because I had heard, particularly from my Solana Beach constituents, that they were concerned about what was going on. And I had talked to such people as our former mayor, Doug Sherris, who's with us today, and Torgan Johnson, Don Mosier, the former mayor and councilmember in Del Mar, Bart Ziegler, and others. They were concerned. Those that had children said, we're really concerned about the future and what this means to us. And when you think that 8 million people live within 50 miles of this plant, I felt it was really important for no matter what level of government I was serving, that I start getting smart on this issue and start asking the tough questions. Well, this past January, I became the first new supervisor in 18 years, and it's my job to ask the tough questions with my colleagues. And that's why when I was approached and asked, would I host this event here at the county, I said, yes, I believe we need to ask these questions. And when I started... And when I started working and hearing from folks, I knew that we needed to get all levels of government involved. Folks don't care whether you're a council member, a mayor, a supervisor, a member of Congress, a senator, or a president. They want us all working together because this is our homes. This is where we live, and this issue is too important to ignore. So I'm really pleased that we've pulled together a phenomenal lineup, and we're really pleased to welcome a great leader from Japan who was at the highest levels of his country's government during its crisis when their nuclear power plant melted down, the former Prime Minister Naoto. And sir, we welcome you here today. We're also pleased to welcome here the former Nuclear Regulatory Commissioners, Gregory, Jaczko, and Peter Bradford, nuclear engineer Arnie, Gundersen, Kendra, Ulrich, who's the nuclear campaigner for Friends of the Earth. And I'm also pleased to have a former fellow colleague who is a mayor of Santa Ana, and we were talking prior to getting this started today, what it's like serving at the grassroots level. When you think San Diego County, we're the second most populated county in California, the fifth most populated county in the United States. And when you think that this area of Southern California is one of the most populated areas in the world, it's critical that we all work together. And I'm really pleased to introduce our moderator for today. He's the mayor of Santa Ana, and he's also chair of the Energy Committee at the Conference of Mayors, the Honorable Miguel Polito, who will be our moderator today. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much, Supervisor Roberts. I know you mentioned to me earlier that you're the first supervisor here in 18 years, and it's just so wonderful to see the work that you're going to do. You also told me you went from a staff of one to a staff of 10. I know all 10 are going to be very busy because you have a lot of energy, and I am so thankful that you're hosting this and inviting us all here to address these important issues. As I begin, I want to take a moment and thank the Samuel Lawrence Foundation. I understand that they've been very helpful in putting this together. And then without further ado, I just want to get into what we're here to talk about. And you know, the fact that we have Naoto Khan, such a distinguished gentleman that was serving as Prime Minister during the critical time that we had, you know, with the accident at Fukushima, I think it makes us all just realize what a wonderful place we live in, but also how quickly that place could change if we had serious problems. And I know that when I was speaking to the Prime Minister earlier, he said, make sure you mention how much he loves San Diego and how nice the people are and how such a, you know, a great time he's having. So I just want to invite you to St. Ana and to Orange County when you're done here, because you will love us as well. And I'll tell you, I think it's important that we're working together between Orange County and San Diego counties, because this impacts all of us. So let me, if I may, sir, as part of the formal introduction, just state for the audience that I think it's very important the fact that you declared the need for Japan to end its reliance on atomic power while you were Prime Minister, and that you dedicated yourself to the promotion of renewable energy sources, and that, you know, when you resigned in August of 2011, you in essence went on to serve the Democratic Party of your country in order to garner support for alternative energy, and so we're eager to hear from you. We're so delighted to have you here, and I know you're going to have a couple translators. I think one tells you what we say, another one tells us what you say, and we have no idea what either one of them are saying. So I'm sure it's going to go very, very well. They're both very good. So with that, let me please turn it over to you, Mr. Prime Minister.
Thank you so much for inviting me. I'm honored to be here in this position and take part in this gathering. First of all, to Mayor Pulido, I would like to make a promise. I will come and visit you in Santa Ana. I have 50 minutes to speak today, and I'd like to speak especially on the events that occurred after 2011,
March 11th. 私のいた国会も大きく揺れました。
On March 11, 2011, at 2:46 p.m. in the House of Parliament building, we felt a huge, huge earthquake.
大きなシャンデリアが揺れて、その下にいる人に落ちるのではないかと心配しました。
The huge chandelier above us was swinging like a chime, and we all thought it would fall.
揺れが止まって、すぐに委員会が休憩になりまして、官邸地下にある緊急の危機管理センターにおりました。
So finally, the swaying from the earthquake was over, and the emergency headquarters underneath the parliamentary area was under emergency lookout.
最初に地震の規模あるいは津波の警報などが入ってきました。
At first, there was the tsunami warning signal and only the earthquake warning signal. That's all we had.
そして原発については最初に入ってきた情報はスクラムによって無事に全ての原発が停止したという情報でした。それを聞いた時にはホッとしました。
So he was relieved to hear the very first information from the nuclear facilities was that it had, without any emergency incident, had gone offline without a problem. And he was very relieved to hear this.
しかしそれから約1時間後に来た情報は、福島第一サイトで全ての電源が喪失したという情報でした。
However, 1 hour later at the Daiichi, which is the first four plants of Fukushima, there was completely different information coming in, and it was not looking good.
で、そのさらに20分後に全ての冷却機能が停止をしたという情報が入りました。
And after that, we heard that all cooling systems were failing.
この電源喪失と冷却機能が停止ということが何を意味するか、私にもその知識がありましたので、本当に背筋が寒くなる、そういう思いをしました。
And what are we going to do? I immediately thought there was a chill that ran down my spine. What are we going to do in order to cool these reactors?
皆さんもご存知のように、原子力発電所は、核反応が止まったからといって、自然に冷えるものではありません。
So as everyone knows, when the reactors go offline, there is absolutely no way to cool them naturally.
自己崩壊熱によって長期にわたって熱が出ます。
So as long as time goes by, it just gets worse and worse, and the heat continues to rise.
特に停止直後の原発では、冷却が止まると、その熱によって、圧力容器の中の水が蒸発してなくなってしまいます。
The biggest problem there with the continuing heating of the reactors is that the steam from the remaining water that's there to cool it down completely evaporates.
実際に福島第一の1号機は冷却機能が停止をして約4時間のうち当日の20時にはメルトダウンを起こしておりました。
Especially reactor 1, we heard 4 hours later because of a lack of water, it did begin to melt down.
しかし、3マイルの事故ではメルトダウンの段階で止まりましたが、福島原発ではメルトダウンでは止まりませんでした。
Three Mile Island, we know now that they were able to stop things before a complete meltdown. We were unable to do this at Fukushima.
この厚さ20センチぐらいのこの圧力容器そのものを溶かして、溶けた燃料は圧力容器から外へ出て格納容器の底にドタドタッとこう落ちた。メルトスルーを起こしたわけです。
The containment vessel is about 20 centimeters, 20 centi.
Yeah.
20 centimeters thick, and it just started melting through and started melting through the corium very slowly.
そして圧力容器の底の約厚さ 2メートルのコンクリートをその熱でえぐり始めました。こう。
And in continuing this process, there is a 2 meter thick concrete containment vessel which also began to leak.
もし、このコンクリートを突き抜けて、溶けた燃料が外に出ていれば、もう誰も近くに近づくことができなくなってたでしょう。
And if you had a complete breach of this 2 meter concrete barrier, there is no way that anyone would even be able to come close to make emergency efforts to contain it.
再燃してその段階で外から水を格納容器に入れて、溶けた燃料の上に水が来る、そういう状態にすることができました。
So then we started adding water. We started pouring water from various areas onto the melted, nuclear fuel, onto the spent fuel that was melting through in order to try to contain this disaster.
そして2年経った今日も、1号機はその時の状態が続いているという。そういう状況です。
Two years later, we are still in the same situation, making efforts at doing this very thing, trying to keep the spent fuel pools cool, adding water in reactor one. We're in the same situation.
もし人間がその近くに近づけば、2分間で命を落とす、そういう高い線量が出てます。
The radiation exposure is so terrible that if a human being comes anywhere near this area in 2 minutes, they would be killed.
そして 3.11 のちょうど24時間後の翌日には、その1号機で水素爆発が起きました。
And 24 hours after this time, there was a hydrogen explosion at reactor 1.
そしてさらに1日置いた3月14日には3号機で、水素爆発が起きました。
And then on March 14, at reactor 4, there was another hydrogen explosion. At reactor 3, pardon me.
そして翌15日、3月15日、東電がこれ以上対応できないので、第一サイトから撤退したいということを申し出てきました。
And on March 15th, we got a report, a warning from the utility saying there's nothing we can do, we want to evacuate.
しかしもし、東電が第一サイトから関係者を撤退させたときには、もう誰もがこの第一サイトをコントロールできなくなります。
If you did that, there would just be, it would spiral out of hand, is what Mr. Khan was believing. There's just no way that I could allow this.
福島第一には6基の原発と7つの使用済み燃料プールがあります。
There are 6 reactors at Daiichi with 7 spent fuel pools.
12キロ先の福島第二サイトにはさらに4基の原発と4個の使用済み燃料プールがあります。
12 kilometers away from the Daiichi, there is the Daini reactors, and those are the Daini plant composed of 4 reactors and spent fuel pools for each.
で、私はチェルノブイリの事故に関しての知識が若干ありました。
So he had studied a lot about Chernobyl.
Chernobyl の場合は4号機が爆発を起こしました。
In Chernobyl, there were 4 reactors which exploded.
しかし、
reactor number 4 only exploded.
事故を起こしたのは原発でいうと1機だけです。1つだけです。
Only one reactor.
もし、福島の場合に第一サイト、第二サイト合わせて10基の原発と11の使用済み燃料プールがコントロールできなくなったときに、放出されるであろう放射性物質はチェルノブイリの何十倍にも達するだろう。そのことを私は考えました。
Okay. What he thought was, if in Fukushima, the 10 reactors with 11 spent fuel pools, if these were all to explode, it would be magnified. The terrible exposure would be magnified by tens and 20 times that of Chernobyl. And this is what he thought about.
そうなった時に、例えば東京を含む地域からも人々が逃げなければなくなるのではないかと考えました。
In this case, it would be definitely necessary to evacuate all of Tokyo.
実際に原子力政策を推進してきた原子力委員会の委員長であった近藤氏に最悪のケースについてシミュレーションを当時依頼しました。
He consulted with the Nuclear Regulatory Safety Commission, and whose name is Mr. Kondo, and they said, "What should we do? What should we do?" And he talked about this with his, with Mr. Kondo.
彼がその後私に出してきたレポートによれば、最悪のケースでは原発から250キロ圏約140マイルでしょうか。その範囲の人々が、避難しなければならないという報告書が届きました。
As he discussed this with Mr. Kondo, they found that in a worst case scenario, it would be very necessary to evacuate a radius of 190 miles from the accident site.
その範囲には東京も含まれます。
And Tokyo is included in this area.
そしてその範囲内に住んでいる日本人の数は5000万人に上ります。
So the only, so if such a scenario were to happen, there would be only 500,000 people left.
現在16万人の皆さんが福島原発事故のために避難をしています。
At the present time, there are 160,000 people that have been evacuated from Fukushima.
彼らは家族がバラバラになり、あるいは仕事を失い、大変、人生のこの形を大きく変えざるを得ない状態に今あります。
As a result, people have had to flee from their jobs. Family members have been spread out all over the country, and the very fabric of the society in Fukushima, their very lives have been completely disrupted and turned upside down.
もし5000万の日本人が住んでいる家を出て、仕事を離れて、学校を離れて、あるいは病院や施設を離れて、逃げ出さなければならなくなったとすれば、その過程でも多くの犠牲者が出たことは間違いありません。
If 500,000 people had to evacuate hospitals, schools, jobs in this whole process, it just would have been, it would have been terrible. Pardon me? 50 million people in a worst case scenario.If they would have had to evacuate their jobs, schools, all of the very functioning mechanisms of the infrastructure during this process, you would have had more problems evacuating the hospitals and the schools because of the evacuation.
同時に、日本は国としての機能を長期間にわたって大きく失うことになったでしょう。
And at the same time, over a long period of time, it would have affected Japan, the whole entire fabric of the country, in the same respect.
私は 3.11 の原発事故が起きるまでは、安全性に注意して、原子力発電所を利用するということに、賛成をしておりました。
Until March 11, 2011, I thought carefully about the safety of nuclear power. My focus was on the safety. How can we safely and effectively use nuclear power to benefit the society?
しかし、この3.11の事故に遭遇してからは考え方を180度変えました。
However, after Fukushima, my whole mindset about nuclear power has changed 180 degrees.
確かに、飛行機が落ちた場合に、多くの人が、数百人の人が亡くなることもあります。また自動車事故で何人かの人が亡くなることがあります。
For example, if an airplane crashes, I look at the loss from the deaths that result from an airplane crash.
しかし一つの事故で、日本の例で言えば、国土の3分の1の地域から逃げていく、あるいは人口の 40% が、その場所から逃げる、そのことが必要となる事故というのは、原発事故以外で言えば、戦争を除けばありえない事故だと思っています。
However, in an accident such as this nuclear accident, you have a situation where 40% of the population leaves their area. It affects one third of that geographical area. It is much, much worse than the scenario of the falling plane or of a war, of an actual war.
まあそう考えると、このリスクの大きさに対して、そうしたリスクを100% 回避する、リスクを回避できる方法というのは、私にはただ一つしかありません、考えられるのは。
And therefore, he began to think that there is only one way to deal with this risk, in one way to effectively deal with 100% this risk of mass destruction. There's one thing I thought about it.
それは、原発を使わないでもいい社会を作る、そのことです。
And the most important thing that I realized was we need a society that has no nuclear power.
you. そしてそのことは十分に可能なことです。
And this is very, very possible.
事故の起きた後に我が国でも太陽光、風力、バイオマスといった再生可能エネルギーを拡大するための制度を作りました。
After the accident, it was very, very important to begin to implement renewables, natural energy, including solar, biomass, wind.
我が国では、3.11 の時点では、そうした再生可能エネルギーは水力以外では 1% 程度しかありませんでした。
Okay. And before the accident, before the 311 accident, aside from hydro propulsion, that sort of renewable energy, there was only 1% of resources were devoted to other renewables.
しかし、その制度ができて今約半年になりますけれども、太陽光発電だけで、その半年間で原発 2.5 基分の計画が進んでます。原発 2.5基分の量、あの発電量の。
Okay. And in the six months since this system of implementing renewables has been instituted, we have been able to access the amount of 2.5 nuclear reactors harnessing of power through solar energy generation.
そして、風力についても今海の上に浮かせる大きな風力発電の計画が進んでます。
There's a big plan and a big there's a big plan right now to implement windmills in the ocean now.
Floating
in the ocean in Fukushima and that's in process.
こうした再生可能エネルギーの拡大は、経済的にも大きな効果をもたらします。
And we are beginning to see that economically this just makes more sense. The renewables are making more sense from the economic standpoint.
その例はドイツに見ることができます。
We can see a very good example by looking at Germany.
ドイツは2022年までに全ての原発を止めることを決めました。
And Germany has decided by 2022 that they will completely be phased out of nuclear power.
そして2050年までには全てのエネルギーを化石燃料もやめて、再生可能な自然エネルギーで代替したいというそういう目標を立てました。
And their goal in Germany is by 2050 to work toward the goal of no fossil fuel energy generation.
原発を次々に減らしているドイツですが、決して経済が停滞はしておりません。
Germany is really on the road to getting rid of nuclear power. However, the economics pose very many questions.
皆さんもご存じのように、今 EU 諸国の中で最も安定的に経済成長を続けているのがドイツであります。
And as everyone knows, however, as everyone knows, Germany, among all of the countries that are trying to phase out and talking about this in their administrations, Germany is the one that is economically balanced in their plan and leads as an example.
また、我が国では原発によって生まれる電気の料金がコストが安いという考え方が今なお根強く残っています。
The problem in my country is that concerning nuclear power, among the thinking groups that are in power, there is still the mistaken thought that the nuclear power generation is cheap.
しかしこの考え方は明らかに間違っています。
But it's completely wrong.
この計算には事故が起きた時の保証などは入ってません。
The calculation for such costs do not take into account any budget at all for what happens, where do the costs come from, where does the money come from for taking care of everything after an accident.
さらには使用済み核燃料の処理にかかる費用も入ってません。
Nuclear waste, dealing with nuclear waste and spent fuel, there is no budget for dealing with this. So these costs are not in the calculation.
まあ、特に日本は地震の多い国でありますので、それを最終的に処分する場所を見つけることは世界のどの国よりも難しい国であります。
And because Japan is a country marked with fault lines, earthquake fault lines, and marked with a history of terrible earthquakes, it is that much harder to find a place, a repository for such nuclear waste and spent fuel.
今世界で、直接使用済み燃料を投棄する具体的な設備を作っているのはフィンランドのオンカロであります。
In the world, the biggest repository for spent fuel is presently in Finland. Finland のどこ？
オンカロ。私はその記録映画を見ました。
He'll talk about this data and he saw a documentary on this repository in Finland.
その題名は日本名では10万年後の安全という題がついてました。
The title of this in Japanese is After 100,000 years. What happens to this repository after 100,000 years?
なぜ10万年かといえば、使用済み燃料の中に含まれているプルトニウムの放射能の強さが半分になるのに2万4000年かかります。
And why are we talking about 100,000 years after an accident? It's because plutonium's half-life is 24,000 years.
4分の1になるのにはその倍の期間、8分の1になるのにはそのさらに2万4000年、つまり16分の1の強さになるのに約10万年かかるわけです。
And the calculation for this, after one fourth of the plutonium reaches that one fourth life, another 24,000 years. One tenth, another 24,000 years. And so finally, you come to the calculation of 1/16 equaling 100,000 years.
つまり10万年間人間から隔離した形で管理する。
In other words, it's us, the humans, it's mankind that needs to babysit this nuclear waste for 100,000 years.
それにかかる費用は私たちが負担するのではなくて、私たちの子や孫やさらにその子や孫が負担することになります。
And the cost, who bears the cost for this? The cost is passed on to the generation after us, and after that, and so on.
まあ、そういう将来の子どもたち、孫たちに危険なものを残して、しかも大きな経済的負担を残すことは、私は我々世代が取るべき道ではない、倫理に反することだと思っています。
And so what I believe is leaving this cost as well as the danger, the risk to our grandkids and to our progeny is not only the risk, but the danger and the responsibility and the financial cost is absolutely ridiculous. I'd like to talk now about the causes for the actual accident at Fukushima.
この原因は 3.11 の前に、ほとんど全ての原因が存在してました。
Most of the cause of Fukushima Daiichi accident lies in what happened before March 11th, 2011.
もともと福島第一のあるところの地形は海面から35メートルの崖で、その上が高台になっていました。 35メートルの
The cliff, okay. So the actual facility is built on a 35-meter cliff above sea level.
そこを海面から10メートルのところまで土を切り取って、高さ10メートルの海面から10メートルのところに6つの原発を設置しました。
And 10 meters above this, we've taken soil and replaced it for an additional 10 meters above that, and that's where it's built, the facility.
つまり、津波はその10メートルの高さまでは届かないという前提でした。
In other words, the idea that a tsunami would not come above this extra 10-meter barrier, the soil that it's built on, was the thinking of the time before the accident.
しかし、あの地域は長い歴史の間で何度も津波が来てまして、今回と同じような大きな津波が数百年前に来たこともあります。
Okay. However, in the very same area, there were many, many tsunamis, and the history, if we look back to the real history, hundreds and hundreds of years ago, there is a recording that tsunamis of the huge impact, of the huge size of 311 did in fact occur.
それなのになぜ10メートルのところまで土を切ったかといえば、冷却のための水を海から汲み上げるのに、できるだけ海に海面に近い方がいいというそういう経済的な理由から10メートルの高さまで土を切ったわけです。
Okay, and why? If we have this information, why did we build it 10 meters above sea level? It's all about economics, and being close to the ocean, it's important to cool these spent fuel rods. Therefore, having the 10 meters, just the 10 meters away, it's closer to the ocean, easier to get that water to cool the spent fuel, and all those decisions were based on cost and business.
また、アメリカでの 9/11 のテロ攻撃の後、アメリカではテロによる全電源喪失を想定して対策を打たれたと聞いてます。
So, in a similar light, in the United States, we had the 9/11 disaster, and as a result of this, there were many, many different programs implemented, agencies implemented, dealing with terrorism.
そうした情報は我が国の当時の原子力安全保安院も情報を受けて、おりました。
This same information was, of course, came into the Nuclear Safety Commission on the Japanese side as a result of 9/11, and they began to think of what to do.
しかし、当時の我が国の政府の姿勢は、日本ではそうしたテロが起きることはないので、それによる全言喪失については考える必要がないと。
However, the politicians took this information with a grain of salt, saying, "We don't have that sort of terrorism. We don't really need to prepare for any sort of a disaster like this."
もしテロによるか津波によるかの差はあっても、全言喪失があり得ると考えて、備えをしていれば、今度のような厳しい事故にはならなかったと思います。
And in my opinion, if we would have implemented safety precautions, preparing for such terrorism or tsunami, that there is a possibility that this could happen. We wouldn't be in the position we are in today.
最後に根源的なことについて、少し私の考えを申し上げたいと思います。
I'd like to talk about the foundations of my thinking, the very base of how I'm thinking about this disaster.
果たして人間は核というものをこのいろいろ操作することによって得られるエネルギーをエネルギーというものと人間というものが共存できるのかという極めて本質的な問題です。
So how does mankind, in manipulating nuclear the nuclear, in manipulating nuclear, how can we coexist with this nuclear energy? How I began to think about this.
プルトニウムという物質は、まあ、自然界にはほとんど存在をしておりません。
In the natural world, plutonium does not exist in naturally above ground around man.
この物質が地球上に現れたのは、まあ、これはあの安子さんや他の皆さんの専門ですが、今から約70年前ではないかと思います。70年ぐらい前だと思います。
The substance of plutonium, we can refer to Dr. Jaczko and the other professionals here on this. However, we've only been around plutonium, humans dealing with this for 70 or 80 years.
今この地球上に生存している生物は地球の環境に適応したものだけが生存していることは言うまでもありません。今地球上に生存している、まあ、人間を含む生存している生物は地球の現在の環境に適応するものだけが今生きているわけです。
Yes. Right now, mankind is dealing with the resources we have, and we've been able to adapt to the natural resources.
もしこの地球がもっと放射能の強い星であったら、あるいはもっと放射能に強い生物が生き残ったかもしれません。
And also, there is the possibility of the radioactivity becoming more and more. And his question is, are we equipped for this adaptability?
あるいはもし地球に酸素がなければ、酸素以外のもので生きる生物が存在したかもしれません。
And without oxygen, we need to look at the history of organisms on this earth. Were there organisms that were equipped to live without oxygen? Looking at all these factors, how are humans dealing with this?
45億年の地球の歴史の中で、その地球のまさに大気とか放射能の強さとかそういうものに適応するものが現在生きているわけです。
In the 45 million year history of the Earth, the only remaining living organisms were the organisms that were able to adapt to the changing environment, the global warming, all of the changes in our oxygen, all of the changes in the elements that keep us functioning and metabolizing.
その地球の環境というものをプルトニウムというものは根源的にその条件を変えてしまう、そういう性格を持っています。
And what I believe is because of plutonium and its recent, the advent of bringing plutonium into the environment of the Earth is basically, I believe that we just can't coexist.
もちろんプルトニウムだけではありません。現在福島ではセシウムがたくさん残っていて、それによる放射線障害が将来に向かって大変心配されています。
And of course, it's not just plutonium, but radioactive cesium in the case of Fukushima that completely puts our adaptability for radiation contamination and exposure and in a completely new realm and dimension.
そういった意味で、地球との環境と人間がこの共存することに対して人間自身がその条件を変えるそのことが許されるのかという非常に根源的な問題です。
And so we return to the basic premise that Living on this earth is mankind. Mankind is manipulating our environment. Can we have created this situation, we are standing at a precipice where we've created the situation, will we be able to survive?
私は少年の時代に父親からギリシャ神話の中にあるプロメテウスの話をよく聞かされました。
When I was a young man, I heard a lot of important thoughts from Prometheus, the Greek Prometheus, from my father.
まあ多くの方もご存知だと思いますが、プロメテウスという神様が火を知らない人間に対して火を教える話です。
And so what we learned from God, Prometheus, was that the people that don't understand about fire are those that are teaching about fire.
で、火は、火は、知恵をも意味します。知恵ですね。
知恵。The fire is the symbol for wisdom.
そのプロメテウスが人間に火を教えたことを知ったゼウスの神が怒るわけです。
And so Prometheus taught this fire, this wisdom to Zeus, the king of the gods.
ゼウスはプロメテウスに対して人間に火を教えたことが人間にとって幸せになると思って教えたんだろうと。しかし大きな災いになるかもしれないんだぞと。
And Zeus said to Prometheus, "Yes, it can bring us happiness, and it can bring us understanding. However, you may end up. It's going to be a rocky road. You may end up with some problems."
Prometheus はそのために永遠に岩山にくくりつけられて腹渡を鷹がついばんだという有名なギリシャ神話の話です。
And therefore, Prometheus was a band sent away far, far away to the caves to be suffering into eternity.
科学技術というのは人類をいろんな面で幸せにし、あるいは便利にしました。
What we've done in the history of mankind is we've created and adapted on the premise of convenience.
しかし同時に、より強力な兵器を生み出し、そして、より大きな事故を起こす原発をも生み出しました。
At the same time, we've created terrible weapons, and in doing so, we've created terrible destruction.
私が政治家を志した一つの理由は、科学技術というものをきちっとコントロールすると。それは政治の仕事だと考えたからです。
Why did I become a politician? I wanted to understand. I wanted to control nuclear. I wanted to figure out a way to control nuclear power.
しかし、残念ながら我が国の原発事故を防ぐことはできませんでした。
And unfortunately, I learned through the Fukushima accident, it's impossible to control nuclear power.
現在アメリカや日本では原発の建設は止まっている、あるいは少なくなっています。
どういう関係が少なくなっている？
原発の新しい建設が、はいはいはい、ストップされているということですね。
Between U.S. and between Japan, in among that relationship, presently, the creation of new nuclear power facilities is, in general, stopped. There is not a surge for creating more.
しかし、いくつかの国では独自のエネルギー源を持ちたいために原発を新たに作る動きがまだ続いています。
Unfortunately, there are other countries aside from the U.S. and aside from Japan that believe that having nuclear is the answer.
例えば、トルコとかインドとかベトナムです。
For example, India, Turkey, Vietnam.
現在日本の原子力メーカーとアメリカの原子力メーカーが共同してそれらの国に 新たな原発を輸出をしようとしています。
And right now, Japan, with the help and support of America, are working with various nuclear makers in order to export that technology.
私も 3.11 の前にはそうした国々の首脳にですね、に対して、日本やあるいは日本とアメリカの共同して開発した原発を最も安全だから導入してほしいということを 3.11 前は提案をしてました。
And even I, to be honest, I was among those promoting because I believe nuclear was the safest form of energy, and I was among those promoting the export of this technology.
しかし今はそのことを恥じております。
But right now I'm terribly embarrassed about this.
今それらの国にとっても将来のことを考えれば新たに原発を導入するのではなくて逆に再生可能エネルギーの技術を導入するそのことがより良いことだと信じるからです。
What I believe now is that we need to think about the future of these countries, the future of these countries that are not prepared in case there was a nuclear accident. We need to promote nuclear, we need to promote renewables, natural, renewable energy to these countries.
現在このサンディエゴの近くの、なんて言いましたっけ、原発は。サンオノフレの原発について皆さん方が心配をされてその再稼働に反対されていることを私もよく知っております。
I'm very, very, I'm reading a lot of information and hearing a lot of information on all of the activists and all of the citizens of Southern California that are working hard to prevent restart at San Onofre nuclear power generating station.
同時に、アメリカにおいても、再稼働させるべきだという人たちあるいは企業が力を持っていることも知っております。
And at the same time, he knows very well in America we have corporations and we have government agencies that are fighting to implement restart.
その状況は日本でも同じです。
It's exactly the same in Japan.
多くの国でも同じ状況です。
And it's the same situation all over the world.
私はそうした世界の動きを見て、やはりこの原発について疑問を持つあるいはそれをやめた方がいいと考える世界の人たちがやはり協力をしてネットワークを作って、事故の危険性あるいは原発のコストの高さを、世界の人々に知ってもらう努力をすべきだと考えます。
What I'm thinking is the most important part to deal with this is to create a network, to create the conversations around the world to discuss this problem. Discuss your doubts about nuclear power, the dangers, the inherent risks of nuclear power, but not only that, the financial costs which are ongoing and future. It is this network that we need to create.
今3基目の原発を作ろうとしている台湾のそれに反対している人たちからも私に一度台湾に来て福島原発の事故について話してほしいという要請が来ております。
Right now he has a request from the people, the activists in Taiwan who are fighting the construction of their third nuclear reactor. He has been invited there to please speak about the terrible Fukushima accident.
今日のこのお招きを受けたこの会がそういう世界での原発をなくしていく動きのある意味でのスタートの会になることを期待しております。
And so it is groups like this, this kind of meeting, this kind of conversation that we should all expect and provide around the world. It is this sort of beginning that is the beginning to the network I'm speaking about.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.